And this morning, we get to even just remember that through communion, which is just one of my favorite things that we do as a body together, is remember communion. We remember what the Lord has done for us. Remember and celebrate the gospel of grace that's been given to each one of us, that our debt has been paid in full by the saving work alone of Jesus. Communion is also a family meal, and it's meant for those who have come to know and place their trust in Jesus and say, I will follow after him. So by receiving it, we remember what he's done for us. And this morning, if you haven't yet come to that place in your relationship with him, we ask that you would just let the elements pass by you today. But please, if that's you, please don't let this moment pass. Please don't let this moment pass without considering the beautiful saving grace of Jesus. 1 John 1:5-9, the Apostle John writes, this is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. So if we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and we don't practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, then we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth then is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so this morning, as we come really together as a body, but before the Lord today, I want us to take a minute. We're gonna sing this song, and while we sing the song, I want you to take a minute and consider the simple question. It's a simple question, but it's a weighty question. Are there any areas of my life in which I am walking in darkness? You guys, I just want you to hear this, that confession is not meant to activate shame. When we confess, we actually find freedom because we practice the truth. So all of us have sin. And when we say that we don't, we deceive ourselves. But it's confession that gives us space for God to deal with our sin. So we're going to look one more time at verse 9. It says, if we confess, which means we talk about, we bring into words what's in my heart. If we confess our sins being the way that we have walked away from the will of God, the perfect will of God, that he is faithful and he is just to forgive us our sin. He removes the penalty and he cleanses us of all unrighteousness. He cleanses us and he removes that defilement. So we're going to take this next minute to do just that, to confess. Speak to the Lord in your heart. Speak to the Lord out loud. Any places that you're walking in darkness. And we're going to ask you to hold on to the elements during this time, and we're going to take them together in just a moment.
White as snow.
church, let's take the bread, which represents the body that was given to us in Christ. The cup that represents his blood poured out for us. Jesus, I'm so thankful for the cleansing blood. I'm so thankful that we have full redemption in you. I'm so thankful that we don't have to walk with the weight of sin and shame in our lives and in our hearts, but we get to freely confess, freely speak to you. Jesus, the places that darkness tries to take root. And it is as soon as we confess, as soon as we speak it to you, how sweet it is, that weight just comes off of our shoulders. So we thank you, Lord, that we can remember your sacrifice this morning. We thank you that we remember the beautiful gospel of grace that is available for each one of us. What hope we have. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. We're going to sing. We're going to sing the rest of this song, and let's sing with the hope and the gratitude that we have.
Amen, church. Man, we get to praise the Lord today. So thankful we get to do that here at this gathering. We do it every weekend. Lift high the name of Jesus. What a privilege, what an honor that we get to do that together. Well, my name is John, and I serve as one of the pastors here. And I got to meet a couple of you who are brand new to Harvest this morning before you came in. And if we didn't have a chance to meet, would you give me that opportunity? I'm going to be hanging out in the lobby after the service. We'd just love to meet you. Or maybe we just have never had a conversation or something that's heavy on your heart or you just wanted to share something. I would love to meet you in the lobby. And so if this is not your first time and you know what we typically do at this point is we look for ways to connect with each other. And one of the ways we can do that is through our app. And so we have a Harvest Bible Chapel app. You can use that to check in, but you can also follow along in the sermon today or submit a prayer request. As a staff, we pray for these every week. And so that's one way that you can engage in that. If you don't have the app, you can scan the QR code on a chair near you, and you can do that even right now. Well, I think about one of the ways that we are trying to help our church connect with each other. We have multiple campuses. And ladies, we want to invite you to be a part of the Women's Conference. It's Women on Mission. And so as we think about these days ahead and how do we gather together and how do we encourage one another, super excited about the opportunity you'll have. It's an all-day conference, and you can be a part of that. One of the guest speakers is Jackie Hill Perry. And Jackie Hill Perry is a passionate follower of Jesus that has a dramatic life conversion. And so I'd love for you to get a little glimpse of that, and you can have a seat while you direct your attention to the screen.
When you stop believing that the location of God's power is in the gospel, you start to develop methods for your ministry instead of praying. You start to trust your strategies more than the Spirit. And this is the thing, conversion is a work of the Holy Spirit. Sanctification is a work of the Holy Spirit. Spiritual understanding and the opening of the mind to understand scripture like Lydia is a work of the Holy Spirit. It does not matter how clever you are, how winsome you are, how interesting you are, or even how intellectual you are. All of those are useful insofar as the Holy Spirit moves. If God doesn't move, people will not respond. But I think we are tempted to draw power from some other source than God as a means of creating what looks like ministry impact. When in fact, it was just manipulation bordering on witchcraft, I said it. A good sermon isn't powerful if the Spirit doesn't move. Good worship isn't powerful if the Spirit doesn't move. Yeah, they cried. Yeah, they lifted their hands, but were they delivered? Were they changed? Were they set free?
Wow, okay. Think about that. We are going to be spending that day focused on the holiness of God and to draw us into that theme, to draw us into that topic. I want to pray for the ladies of our church, even in a moment, that the Lord and His Spirit will have the freedom to reign on that day. There's a couple of other things I'd like to draw our attention to. One of them is Pastor Junior Sigler. Every week we pray for a local church that's sharing the gospel, and it's in Des Plaines. It's called The Bridge. And so I'd love for us to be praying that the Spirit of the living God would flow in their worship center today. And as they scatter on mission, that God would do a great work through that church in Des Plaines. And you think about us right here and the opportunity we have to worship this King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We also have an opportunity to give. We give during the week in many different ways with our gifts and our talents and abilities. But as we think about stewarding the funds that the Lord has given to us, this verse I'd love to read over us. It said, "You will be enriched in every way to be generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God." That's the heart posture that the Lord wants from us. Whether you're giving today, and there's ways that are listed on the screen for you to do that, or you give during the week, the Lord wants our hearts to be thankful for all the ways that He's provided, all the ways that He shows up, but He also wants us to have a heart of generosity, that He might give more and that we can watch Him do a great work. Listen, church, God's doing a great work in our church and in our community, and we get to watch that. And so let's be thankful for things like that. And let's look for more ways that we can give to the work of the Lord. Would you join me in prayer? Father, I'm thankful for the chance we have as a church just to pause right now and just be thankful for the many ways that you are showing yourself and the many ways that we believe you are going to show yourself. For the ladies in this room that have had reservation about signing up, I pray that you would just release them from that and just allow them to experience a day in your word. Would you refresh them? Would you revive them? Would you just give them what they need to experience you in a greater way in your holiness? Pray for Pastor Junior today as he is at the bridge and he's going to be sharing from your word, that you would just allow the Spirit to reign in that room. And for us today, Lord, I'm thankful. I'm thankful that you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and we can lay our lives before you asking for you to do a great work. And these monies that come in, Lord, they're yours. And so we just use them to further your kingdom's work, we pray. And it's in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Psalm 23, David writes that even when I'm seated at the table and my enemies surround me, that he can enjoy a feast because he sits there at the table of the Lord. Doesn't matter what circumstance we're in, it doesn't matter where we are, what season we're in, but his goodness is with us, it's chasing after us, because he is good. That's who he is. So even if you're in a season right now where you might not be able to say with certainty that he is faithful today, we remember that throughout our lives, he has always been faithful. In all of the circumstances of our life, he has been faithful 100% of the time. And let that encourage you this morning that he will be tomorrow and the next day. Amen. Amen. It's good to worship. You guys can go ahead and take a seat. Take out your Bibles.
Great to see you. It's great to be back here in Elgin. All the rest of the campuses, it's awesome to have you guys join us. One of the things that I wanted to do before we started studying God's Word, which we're going to be in the book of Jonah in the next few minutes, just so you know. When I first arrived here, one of the surprising facts that I had learned right before I came was that the church was in a significant amount of debt. It's usually something you want to know before you make a decision to go. But when I first arrived here, I think the number was about, I remember it's $33.4 million of debt, which obviously is a lot. I remember it because we were praying every day at 3:34 that the Lord would do something about the debt. Anyway, I'm here to tell you actually that by God's grace, we've actually reduced the debt down to $29.8 million, which is really cool. I mean, some people are like, what? We're cheering for $29 million. But, right? It's the trajectory that we're excited about. But I actually just wanted to take the opportunity to thank you all for your faithfulness. I really feel like the Lord is doing a great work here at Harvest. It is such a blessing to see a church renew. And I pray that you feel it. I pray that you're excited that you're part of it. Selah. If you have a Bible, again, I'd love for you to open it to the book of Jonah. It's only a little book, a little tiny book in the Old Testament. You know this, but stories have a remarkable power. Usually, we tell our cultural values through our stories. So if I want to communicate something to someone, I don't just, communicate something to my kids. I don't just do it by lecturing them about that particular subject. I might tell them, hey, these are the kinds of things we as a family value. And then I'll tell a story to reinforce that value, because the story is going to stick with them far longer than, the statements do. And this is the way the world works, basically, that you can tell a culture's values throughout the history of the world by the kinds of stories that they tell. So that means that I could probably go to the movies these days and I could find out what are the cultural values, or go to TV or Netflix or whatever. I can go and find out what the cultural values are of our society by just looking at them. If you're an alien and you show up right now, if you're an alien here today, welcome. If you're an alien and you show up and you want to find out the values of a particular culture, you just need to watch, a day of Netflix or go to the movie theater for a couple days and watch all the films. What you'd find out, of course, is that in our culture, we value things like perseverance. Rudy, Rudy, Rudy. Some of you know the movie Rudy, because you're looking at me like you don't. right? But Rudy keeps going, no matter what. Frodo keeps going. He's got to get to Mordor, for those of you younger. Miles Morales in the Amazing Spider-Man movies, Into the Spider-Verse. He keep getting back up. Yeah, we value that kind of stuff. And you can see it in the way that we treat our sports heroes and stuff. If they fall down and then they're a comeback story, we love them even more. You do you. That's Disney's like mode. That's what they should put. Disney, you do you. That's their, because all their movies are basically that. Find out who you are, pursue exactly who you are, and don't let anybody tell you any differently. Justice. We love things. We love it when the bad guy gets it and when the good guy doesn't ever get it, right? Jason Bourne. We think Jason Bourne's the greatest. We need more Jason Bournes in the world. Evil should get it in the end. Fathers are dumb. Now, that might surprise you, but seriously, think about this for the last while. Who are the heroes in our TV shows and movies over the last number of years? There's very few, like, fathers, like Father Knows Best. Those of you who are really old, you remember Father Knows Best, or even in the 1980s, Family Ties. The father was always the right, he was always a good dude. He was always doing the right kinds of things. But nowadays, you've got Homer Simpson, right? Though. Peter Griffin, Family Guy. I mean, he's an idiot. If you ever watch a movie, it's always the dad who's doing the stupid things and the wife who's coming along and going, okay, and she's like the smart person in the room who's trying to make everything go well. And if you look around our society now, that's pretty much the way most guys are told that they are supposed to act. We always wonder why it is that so many fathers act so stupidly. Well, they're told all the time in the movies that that's exactly what they're supposed to be like. The smart person in the house is the mom. She's the one everybody should listen to. Father just goofs around all the time and does crazy things that cost money and embarrass the family. You can tell a culture's values by the stories that they tell in their movies, in their writings, in those sorts of things. Jonah's a story like this. Jonah is a story that reveals something shocking, quite honestly, about Israel in the days that it was written, but it has enormous impact for people like you and me today. I mean, most people, even if you go out into the streets today and they're not, have no Christian background, and you mention the word name, do you know Jonah and the whale? They'll be like, oh yeah, yeah, I know that story. Because it's lasted for so long. It's a great story. It's a surprising story. The guy who's supposed to be the good guy is kind of not the good guy, and at the end you expect him to come around, but he doesn't really come around. Whole thing ends on a question. You ever gone to a movie like that where it sits down and it ends and nothing's really resolved and you're like, well, that was stupid. That's what this is. Surprising turns of events. Amazing, you know, things. The dude lives in a whale for a couple days or a fish for a few days. Great story. Somebody should make a movie about this story. So here's what I want to do over the next 4 weeks. We're going to actually study this book in 4 bites. We should probably just do it in one sitting. It's meant to be read in one sitting. So if you go home sometime or in the next 4 weeks, you're just sitting around and you're thinking to yourself, oh, okay, what should I do? Should I look at Instagram or Twitter? Think, no, I should read the book of Jonah. Read the book of Jonah just all the way through and you'll kind of catch some of the nuances and twists and turns that are meant to be seen. But we can't do that all at one time. So I want to break it down into 4 pieces. This first piece today, okay, you ready for it? Is only the first 3 verses, because I can't help myself. All right? It's only the first three verses. Jonah 1:1-3. And in this passage, we're going to learn a couple of things. Number one, we're going to learn about the primacy of preaching. And two, we're going to learn about the foolishness of fleeing. Primacy of preaching and the foolishness of fleeing. What do I mean by those two? Well, let's just get into the book itself, the primacy of preaching. Jonah chapter 1, verse 1. Now, the word of the Lord came to Jonah. This is a standard way that you talk about a prophet who is receiving. If you're people in Israel, they would be accustomed to that. If you've read the Bible very much, you're accustomed to this kind of language. All right, there's a prophet And God's going to come to him, tell him to go and say something to a group of people. He's going to go say, face a whole lot of difficulties, but they're going to repent or something to that effect. That's what's expected here. Word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, get up, arise, get up. I want you to go to Nineveh, that great city. All right, what makes Nineveh so great? This is probably not a qualitative term. It's not like God saying, it's a really great city. You're going to love it there. They have a bean. You know, they're not. What he means is it's huge and important and valuable. And that's certainly the way people viewed Nineveh in those days. It was large and very important. It was one of the chief cities of the nation of Assyria. And these, you know, language like this, Assyria, what is that? Well, compare it to this, right? It was like one of the big superpowers of the day. So back in the Cold War, we had, what, the Soviet Union and the United States superpowers. We might have, what, China today and the United States. And you fill in the blank with whatever one. It was one of those. One of the biggest, most militaristically powerful places in the entire world at the time. And its chief cities, one of them was Nineveh. So it is Chicago, very similar to the importance that Chicago has. And just like Chicago, it was pretty wealthy. I know that might not sound true, but we are at the crossroads of a whole bunch of places. People go through Chicago to get to other places. We have this massive airport, and that's made us a center of commerce. Well, this is a map. Are you ready for my map? Let's just have an open mind. There's a river, it's called the Tigris River that kind of runs north-south, and then there's a main road that ran east-west, and right here was the city of Nineveh. So just like when you drive in around the country this summer, and you'll be driving along a road, and all of a sudden there'll be a whole bunch of built-up stuff where there's a port, and the highway goes through it, and it's a bigger town than, say, the little town that's on Route 66 that used to be big, but now that the road is not heavily traveled, it's not as big. That's what happens when you have crossroads of big-time travelers. You have major cities, and that's where the banks grow up. That's where all the industry grows up. Chicago. Wealthy city. Large and important city, really idolatrous city. At most of the locations like this, when you had a crossroads of, you know, whether it's roads or the waterways, you would usually have the temples of different gods and goddesses that would be built up there. They'd be on the highest hills around or something like that. Because, you know, if you're on a boat and you're traveling up the Tigris, you want a place to stop so you can worship your god or goddess. Well, Nineveh was that place, and the chief goddess of Nineveh was Ishtar, the goddess of sexual love and war, because those go together, right? Maybe. Most scholars end up saying, well, she was probably the god of the passions, right? The really passionate, heavy, that. So people these days have written long, actually, articles about how it is that the modern Ishtar is Wonder Woman. Which is kind of true, right? You don't want to get in Wonder Woman's way. She'll beat the living daylights out of you. But she's also kind of hot, right? That's Ishtar. And the worship of Ishtar, of course, if you're the goddess of sexual love and war, guess how they worshiped her? So violent, violent worship, violent followers who would do whatever they could to their enemies, right? And the worship of her involved a lot of prostitutes. So sexually immoral city, filthy, barbaric city, important city. In fact, a lot of the language that's used of Nineveh in this book sounds very much like the language that was used about Sodom and Gomorrah. And that's on purpose, because you're supposed to think, Nineveh, what a dump. God should get them. God should get that great city. What is he supposed to do when he gets there? Oops. Word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, And what you're supposed to do is I want you to call out. This word means preach, proclaim. I want to call out against it. Why? Because their evil has come up before me. So the thing that God's really concerned about is the same thing he was concerned about with Sodom and Gomorrah. Their wickedness had come up before the Lord. One of the, you need to know kind of what everyday life was like in ancient cities, because it's very different than what we have. You know, we have street sweepers and fire departments and indoor plumbing. They did not. Cities in the ancient world were just gross. Just gross. But they were where you wanted to live because they were walled in, and that's protected you from invading armies or things like that. So you might have land outside the walls of this city, but you lived in the city for protection. So this is a grand, huge walled city, Nineveh. You'd walk through the main gates, and then you'd go through. And of course, if you're going to go into the city and you're going to worship your deity, usually you have to bring a sacrifice. And so as you're walking through the city, you're bringing your sacrifice with you. And those sacrifices, right, sheep, goats, these sorts of things, they don't always defecate in the appropriate spaces, right? And people don't carry the little baggies around their hands and pick it up. They don't do that. So on the streets, you find a lot of, well, feces. So the stink, right? Just think about the smell that would, Rockford smell. I'm kidding, I just tease Rockford because it's near, right? But it's a smelly, smelly spot. Now you say, well, you could close your windows. They didn't have windows. They had, of course, open air windows. Apartments were built, because you know, if you're in a walled city, the real estate is really, you know, prime. Every little location, you can't build out. Nobody's going to have a half acre lot and think, I want to have a playground for my kids. No, you're going to live in apartments which are poorly built because they didn't have, you know, as frustrating as we find our cities and their codes, they didn't have any of those, right? There was no Nineveh Department of Housing that came along and said, you need to have a handrail down those stairs so no one falls. They just built these buildings up. In fact, there used to be a saying in ancient Rome that every day you could hear an apartment complex falling. So like this is one of the common sounds in the city. You walk by, you're like, what is that? Oh, so don't worry about it. It's just an apartment complex coming down. The poorer people lived on the top floors. Because indoor plumbing's a problem. And so if you live on the bottom floors, you can actually use some facilities, right? But if you're on the top floor, you got to use whatever you got around the house, and then you throw it out the window to join with all the other stuff in the street that's already there. Really, really gross. They had a lot of eye diseases. One of the challenges in ancient cities is because you have all of this junk in the middle of a street, there's a lot of flies that show up. And of course, flies start getting into the junk in the street, and they fly up, go through the open windows, and you got little Tommy in his bassinet there. And he lands on little Tommy's eye, and now little Tommy's got conjunctivitis. And there's no antibiotics for that kind of thing. And so eyesight was a real problem in the ancient world. Lots and lots of people couldn't see well because, you know, as children, they had horrible conjunctivitis and things that made their vision bad for years. And it wasn't just that baby. I mean, he goes up, flies on that baby, and then takes the conjunctivitis and goes to the next house, this little fly, and lands on little Susie. How do you cook? Well, you have to have an open fire, which for those of you who don't know, that's not safe in crowded apartment buildings. Like, we have codes against it for a reason. If you decide to build a campfire in the middle of your house right now, someone's going to get upset with you. But in those days, that's how you cooked. You had an open fire. And of course, if you have an open fire, there's a good likelihood that the thing's going to burn down. And again, there's no fire department. So real problems in the city of Nineveh. Now, I'm telling you all of this because if you and I were to take like a mission trip or like, hey, let's do a tour of Nineveh. We get there, go outside the wall, start walking through. You would be walking through and you'd be like, this city's got a lot of problems. And those problems that you're talking about would be material and social. If we're going to do anything for this city, you know, it would be helpful if we maybe built a fire department, or it might be built clean wells or democracy, right? It's a lot of material things that we would end. If we came out and now we were going to actually give word to our friends, we want you to give money so that we can go to Nineveh. What would we do for Nineveh when we went there? Well, we would go and we would say, we're going to do this really cool, tangible thing. We're going to give them wells and we're going to do all these things. And people would say, yes, that's exactly what they need, these material solutions. And yet the Lord, when he gets a chance to actually say something or do something in Nineveh, he tells Jonah, I want you to go call out against it. What's that gonna do? Hey, Nineveh, this whole place is a mess and you're deep trouble, you know? Don't call out against it. Solve the problems. And yet, Yahweh's trying to solve the problem because here, now listen very closely to me. Social and material ills, as real as they are always downstream from moral and spiritual ills. Social and material ills are always downstream from moral and spiritual ills. In other words, the things that we see around our society these days that really plague us and give us all sorts of difficulty, the things we want to say, we need justice for that, and that needs to be sorted out, and the water, and the blah, 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 are all real things that need to be sorted out, but they are not primary things. The primary thing is sin. The primary thing is that there's wickedness inside of us that we have a hard time stopping. There's a passage of scripture. I wrote my master's thesis about the passage in Romans chapter 7. Those of you who are part of the church and been around for a long time know that Romans 7 is a passage that says, whatever I don't want to do, but evil that I don't want to do is what I do. Oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from the body of this death? And there's a big debate in the Christian church throughout centuries, basically, about who is he talking about? Is he talking about himself, Paul, as a Christian? Or is he talking about himself, Paul, before he was a Christian? There's a whole bunch of arguments all around that. I'm really confident that it's about someone who's before a Christian. We can talk about that later, I promise. But listen, what he's describing in this passage is basically, here's a guy who desperately wants to obey the law of God, like all sorts of Jewish people did. They were like, yes, Lord, Ten Commandments, I'm with you. And I want to now obey the law of God, right? Do not murder, do not covet. Okay, I'm not going to covet. I'm going to actually bless instead of curse. And then they try to do it and something stops them. This is the plight of every unregenerate person, every person who is apart from Christ, who is in their old nature. This is the plight of everyone. Yes, we have all of these rules and we want to keep them. They're good rules. We want to keep them, but the problem is not the rules. The problem is our ability to do them because something's stopping us. And what Paul describes in Romans 7 is, he calls it sin in my members, members being hands and head and leg. There's a blockage, he says. So all of the good works that we should do, right? The building of the wells and doing all of those sorts of things. Yes, they're helpful. But unless there's something that goes on inside of our hearts, they're just window dressing. Because unless you get the root out, the weed will keep growing. You know this. It'll look good for a real short period of time. You're like, look what I did. I ripped that weed out of that yard. In your face, weed. And then 2 days later, Louise's like, what was that? I want you to go and preach against them because their evil has come up against me. Did you catch the language though? It's right here. I want you to go and I want you to call out against it. Jonah, go to the great city of Nineveh, and I want you to call out against it. That's a little weird, see, because here's what I want it to say. I want you to call out to it. I want you to call out for it. I want you to call out about it. What'd you call it? With it. People will receive it better if you're with them. When Jonah goes and finally gets there, right, there's this fish involved in all this, but eventually he gets there. He spit up on the beach and he heads to Nineveh and he's like, all right, you know what his sermon is? Ready? It's the best sermon ever. It's what preachers want to say to their people for years. Yeah, 40 days and you're all dead. And you're like, where's the hope? He left the hope out. 40 days, you're dead. I'm going to go up on the hill and watch it. So he goes, he actually does. He goes out and he preaches against them, against their wickedness, against their sin. Can you imagine if I said that to you today? That, look, what are we going to do this week in the ministry? Well, I'm going to get together a group of people. We're going to go down to the bean, and we're going to stand around it, and then we're going to turn out to everyone, and we're going to preach against them. Who's in? Now, I know there are some people in the room who are like, finally. You know, I've got a lot of things to share with these people, right? I'm going to preach it. But how would they receive that? Seriously, if we went down there and said, we'd be arrested. We'd be certainly on TikTok, right? There's no question that we'd be in the Instagram and all over the Twitter and look at these people. How horrible is this? And we'd even get Christian people end up saying to us, what a wicked, horrible thing to say, because people don't need to know about the judgment of God. They need to know about the love of God. But listen very closely, the love and judgment of God are tied together. How? Well, the answer to that question is pretty easy, but before I give it, can I just tell you where we've been as a church? Because the reason that this is hard for us is pretty much, in my opinion, because there was a time in the Christian church that the only thing that people heard, talking about kind of the, you know, 40, 50, 60s, these kinds of eras, if you were a conservative Christian church, what you would hear most every Sunday is, you're going to hell! And in that tone, hell-y, hell, over and over and over and over and over again. And people just got sick of it after a while. Like, I know, we're horrible. And then eventually some people came around and said, well, actually what people need is they don't need to just hear about hell. They need to hear about the love of God. And they're right. They're right. It's my belief they need to hear about both. But like, they're right. And so what they ended up doing is saying, like some Christian leaders have over the last while, well, that's not really our message, meaning the message of hell and judgment. That's not really our message. What's our message? Our message is the love of God and the kindness of God and the compassion of God. And that's what people need to hear about. So what you have now is a bunch of churches that have basically abandoned any talk about judgment. And what they do is they try to sell Jesus to people as an addition to their already kind of settled life. Hey, take on Jesus. He's going to make everything better. I mean, it's good now, but it'd be even better. You'll have purpose and you'll have, you know, no stress. I've actually heard that. Jesus will give you less stress, said no martyr ever. Guy recently actually said, why should you come to faith in Jesus? Why should you follow Jesus? Well, he makes my life better and makes me better at life. Now look, that might be true. But I do find it really interesting that when you go to the scriptures and you actually have people proclaiming the message of salvation to people, the reason that it's called salvation, saving, is because there's something you're being saved from. And so you're supposed to go, Jonah, and you're supposed to preach against it. For evil is against what? Against the evil of the people in the city. You need to go and declare how I feel, says the Lord, about the evil of the people in the city. Why? Because I love them. Now listen, like I said, those go together. I'll show you how. So this is in Jonah, the very end of the book. So we're reading the first verses of the book, and now this is the very end of the book. Jonah chapter 4, verses 10 and 11. So they repent, gave it away, you don't need to come back. Okay, they repent. Nineveh, he preaches this really bad sermon to them. They all repent, showing the power of God to do stuff with this message. And anyway, he ends up getting upset because this, which is sort of the twist in the story, because how dare they repent and how dare God give them opportunity to repent. So he's sitting on a hillside and he's irritated and he's hot because the sun's beating down on him, and the Lord grows a plant behind him and it gives him shade. And he's like, oh, finally shade. And then the next day the plant dies and he's like, And so the Lord, this is the end of the book. I told you it ended on a question. Here's the end of the book. And the Lord said, you pity, this word means you're concerned about, you pity the plant. Like, you're sitting here moaning and complaining and kind of angry because of the plant for which you did not labor, nor did you make it grow. It came into being in a night and it perished in a night. Like, you had nothing to do with the plant, and yet here you are caring a great deal about its health. Should I then not pity, be concerned about, have compassion on Nineveh, that great city, question mark? The one that with the people that I made and I established, should I not? You're mad about the plant and you had nothing to do with it. Shouldn't I have the right to be upset and want to reach out to these people who I made? When the Lord pities, he sends someone to preach against. Just think about that for a minute. It's so countercultural for us. If the Lord pities and wants to have compassion on somebody, he does not go and affirm. He goes and he alters. You know, this is something that happens throughout the scriptures, to be honest. There's the story of the rich ruler and Mark, the way that Mark tells this story in the Gospel of Mark. The rich ruler is comes to Jesus, rich guy. What do I have to do to eternal life? Jesus says, keep the commandments. I kept them all, he says, which is a lie. And Jesus is like, okay, let's put it to the test. Now, he's about to tell this rich man to give away all his money, which, you know, if you spend time around rich people, is a kind of not a discussion you have around Thanksgiving, okay? So he's about to do this. It's the hardest thing he's ever gonna have to say to this guy. He's gonna be like, yeah, your money's an idol to you, and I need you to give it up so you can come follow me. And Jesus, looking at him, loved him. Okay, what's the evidence that he loved him? Well, because he said this, you lack one thing, go sell that all that you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. Listen, you're banking your life on the treasure that you have, and I'm trying to give you a greater treasure, but in order for you to have the greater treasure, you got to give up all the treasure you love so much. And this confrontation, this call to give away all that he has, is an act of love. So listen, when the Word of God pokes you, when you feel the conviction of the Holy Spirit, what you're experiencing is actually the love of God. When somebody stands up and plays the prophet and says, this is not right, and we're like, ah! He's acting out of love. He's preaching against because he loves. There's a article that I read this last week that I just loved, so I want to read you a little extended portion of it. It's from a website called Desiring God, which I highly, highly recommend to everybody. If you like devotional material and all sorts of stuff, it's John Piper's ministry called Desiring God. Greg Morse is one of the writers there, and here's what he wrote. He said, the world is a doorway into eternity, a fact that few today consider and fear. Sinners frolic before the Almighty God, daring to provoke him to his face. Although God hates all evildoers, according to Psalm 5, verse 5, he burns with indignation toward the unrepentant every day, according to Psalm 7, verse 11, and is even now whetting his sword and bending his bow in judgment, according to Psalms 7, verses 11 to 13. Despite all of these facts, the unrepentant go about life unmindful of their predicament. They slumber atop an active volcano. They mistake the God of delayed wrath for the God of no wrath at all. They hear about the nuclear bomb of eternity, but are self-assured that it will never detonate. They approach the God of the Bible like some do those British royal guards, mocking, poking, testing him to see if he'll move, never realizing that the rifle has lowered until it's too late. And they love the God they've created. Their God is never angry with them. Their God is only merciful, only forgiving, only compassionate. Their God serves the creature and simply pours forth unconditional love and affirmation when and how the creature calls for it. But this God's a pipe dream. This God is actually a demon. This God's absent from the whole of Scripture. Look, even now, the true God holds the unrepentant by the nape of the neck to do them unspeakable injury if they will not bow to his great love and mercy and take up his terms of peace and eternal joy offered them in the blood of his own son. So love invites us, compels us, demands that we speak. The unbelieving live but breaths away from eternal pleasure or eternal pain. Amazing grace or everlasting justice. Are we to say nothing or like mumble about it as if it's not true? So let's resolve together with Charles Spurgeon, who said these words. If sinners be damned, at least let them leap to hell over our dead bodies. And if they perish, let them perish with our arms wrapped about their knees, imploring them to stay. And if hell must be filled, let it be filled in the teeth of our exertions, and let not one go unwarned and unprayed for. Look, God so loved the world that he sent his own son to die for his people's crime. Jesus took our place atop the volcano. He willingly traveled through hell's door and became our door into heaven. He was pierced by the Father's glistening sword, struck by his full quiver of arrows. See, God's firing squad took aim at him, and deafening shots thundered upon Calvary. He walked into the furnace of God's judgment. He plunged the depths of the lake of fire. He was tormented. He was crushed. He drank the cup of God's anger, poured out full strength. Hell's mouth gaped open to receive us. But he stood alone and shut the hell up for his people. And on Sunday, he rose in victory. See, death, sin, Satan lay shuddering beneath his feet. It is finished. There is great danger for the sinner, but also great mercy. Should we not loudly announce both? I'm actually trying to preach against you right now. Not because I'm mad at you, not because I think that you or me, like that I'm somehow better than you, or not in any way like that. Actually, I'm preaching against you because I've come to love you. I really have. I don't want to see any person who is listening to me right now enter the gates of hell unwarned and unprayed for. You could walk out, seriously, if you are here and you have wonders about whether or not you follow Christ at all, you could walk out of the doors of this church today fully confident of everlasting joy in Christ. And know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you will not face the justice of God, which you so richly deserve, because the one who did not deserve it richly gave you himself in your place. I mean, that's a pretty good deal. It's a pretty good deal. The primacy of preaching. All right, the foolishness of fleeing. My favorite part of this passage is right here. Jonah rose to flee to Tarshish. Okay, wait a minute. Wait, what? So here's the way it works. Usually when the word of the Lord comes to somebody and they don't want to do it, like Moses at the burning bush, they end up having a dialogue with God about why they don't want to do it. And the Lord kind of reassures them and then might get a little bit upset with them at the end because he's like, knock it off, just go, right? And then the prophet's like, yeah, okay, I'll go. You're God, I'm not. I'll go. Those are the only examples we have in the Bible. Either a prophet gets the word of the Lord and he goes right away, or the prophet gets the word of the Lord and he has a little argument about it, and then he goes. But Jonah's a special guy. But he gets the word of the Lord, and you're expecting in the next verse, and he went to Nineveh. But Jonah rose to flee to, there it is. Okay, Tarshish, another map. You ready for my, this is the Mediterranean world I'm about to do. So you know, the Mediterranean Sea, there's a Spain here and it comes all the way over here, and there's Italy sort of a boot. And then it comes over here, it looks like a Christmas stocking, but it's a boot. Now it eventually goes here, and then Greece sort of comes down, and then you're over here, and then this is what we call the Middle East. Jerusalem, Israel's over here, and then of course you have North Africa, and it comes up. This is the Straits of Gibraltar. It's pretty good, right? But if you look at it on its side, it looks like an animal trying to bite. Anyway. So here is Jerusalem, where he is. Here's Nineveh. It's in the present day nation of Iraq. Go to Nineveh. Proclaim the word that I want you to preach against them. And Jonah says, okay, he gets up. He goes down to Joppa, which is on the coast. And he goes to, wait for it. Tarshish. What? What are you doing? Now I'm going to go, but seriously, in those days, this is the edge of the known world. I am going to New Zealand. Do you understand? I'm going to get away from you as much as we can. Jonah rose to flee to Tarshish, and this is from the presence of the Lord. Really? Really? Oh, he's not going to find me there. I swear. It's going to be so easy. What an idiot, right? Because that's what you call somebody who gets a message from the word of the Lord himself and calls him to go and do this. He's a prophet. He's like a believer. And a believer who gets the word of the Lord, right? The authoritative word. And then they're told, go do this thing. And then they're like, I'm not only not going to do that thing, I'm going to go the exact opposite direction because you can't do anything about it. What do you call someone like that? Well, an idiot. Why? Well, a couple reasons. Number one, there is no place from the presence of the Lord. And the idea that you can somehow run somewhere that he's not going to be able to find you, it's the same as what Adam and Eve did in the garden. Hide! And second, there is a long history of people who have tried to run from the Lord, and it always gets worse. It always gets worse. You know, in those days, one of the things you need to know is that in the sea itself was viewed as the most dangerous place anywhere, because there's stuff underneath the surface of the water, the Leviathan and other animals that we don't know anything about. If you want to stay safe, you stay on land. But then he goes out into the sea. He takes on the greatest danger in his entire world to try to run away from this God who's called him to go to. It's even worth it, the danger to him, to run away from God. He goes exactly in the opposite direction. Why? Like, seriously, what is going on with this dude? Why would he run away so much like this? Well, okay. The first time that we meet Jonah in the entire Bible is in 2 Kings chapter 14. which says, in the 15th year of Amaziah, the son of Joash, king of Judah, Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king of Israel, began to reign. Jeroboam is beginning his reign in Samaria. And he, Jeroboam, reigned 41 years. That's a good long reign for your kingdom. And he did, Jeroboam did what was evil. Same word as what he's supposed to preach against, Jonah. And he did what was evil in the sight of the Lord. He did not depart from all the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, which he made Israel to sin. So here is a wicked king leading a portion of God's people down wickedness. What should he get? Well, he should get some judgment, right? Because that's what happens. He should get some judgment. God should come, send a prophet, declare to him something, and he should repent and come back. The Lord restored, listen, the border of Israel from Lebo Hamath. Instead of coming and bringing judgment, the Lord actually gives them grace. He says, oh, I'm going to give you more land. This wicked king, he restored the border of Israel from Lebo Hamath as far as the Sea of Arabah, according to the word of the Lord, the God of Israel, which he spoke by his servant Jonah, the son of Amittai, the prophet who was from Gath-Hepher. Okay, think about this for just a second. So here's Jonah. He receives a word from the Lord. He goes and he proclaims it to Israel. And Israel receives pardon and increased land, blessing from the Lord. Jonah has been on the front lines when God sent a word to a wicked nation and then blessed them. Fast forward, Jonah's just sitting around in Jerusalem having a good old time, and the Lord of the Lord comes to Jonah, son of Amittai, and he says, rise up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to them. His history is, look, okay, Lord, you bring repentance and forgiveness and restoration to people that I proclaim to. I've seen it happen. So why does he take off and leave? He doesn't want his world to work like that, because there's a difference between Ninevites and Jewish people, right? Ninevites are gross. They're not your people, God. They don't deserve that. Jonah chapter 4, verse 1. He actually tells you why it is that he gets so upset. Why it is he ran away. It displeased Jonah exceedingly, right? So all the people repent in Nineveh. It displeased Jonah exceedingly. Which is what most Christians feel, right? When their friends and neighbors come to faith in Christ. Right? Ah, it stinks. And he was angry. And he prayed to the Lord. And here's his reason for running. Oh, Lord, is this not what I said when I was yet in my own country? This is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish. Because I knew that you're a gracious God and merciful. I knew it. That you have grace and mercy. You're slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and you relent from disaster. Oh, I knew you'd do this. So why does Jonah run? Well, he doesn't want his world to work like that. See, Jonah's got a viewpoint about his world that the way that he thinks it should function is the best way. And along comes God, and by the power of his word, says, no, I want it to function this way. And Jonah says, not on my watch. Not on my watch. So here's the thing. There's a little bit of Jonah in everybody. How? Okay, So a guy goes to church for a long time with his wife. They're faithful members, in fact, of the church. They serve all over the place. It's great. They've always really enjoyed the marriage sermons, you know, Ephesians 5. Husband likes it because it says to the wife, submit to your husband as the church submits to Christ. But the word actually to the husband in that passage in Ephesians 5 is love your wife like Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. In fact, in the past, he's actually been part of that kind of discussion as he led his small group on how it looks like to love your wife as Christ loved the church. But you know, they've been married 27 years now. Kids are out of the house and she doesn't look like she used to. And all those little naggy things that she's done are really starting to drive him absolutely crazy. He feels alone. You know, his emotional life and intimacy with his wife is really waning. And so what does he do? He meets a young woman at work. So here's a guy who's heard the word of the Lord. Love your wife as Christ loved the church and give yourself up for her. And what he said is, I don't want my world to work like that. So I'm going to Tarshish. So you've been hurt. Welcome to the club, right? I mean, everybody's been hurt at some level or another. Some have been hurt for a lot more than others, though. And when you're mowing the lawn or you're folding the clothes or you're working in the garage or you're going for a walk on your own, sometimes the thought of the person who hurt you rolls through your mind. And then you have a rehearsed conversation that you've rehearsed for a long time regarding what you really would like to say to them if nobody was else around. You're stuck in an elevator and you're both going to die. You're going to say something to this person and you have your rage fantasy at this moment, right? Like we all do. And then you go to church. I mean, it's not bugging you that much, but you're bitter. You go to church, you see the Lord's Prayer. At the end of it, it says, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Other passages, forgive as Christ forgave you. And you're like, yeah, but I'm not like that person, right? I've been forgiven, but I'm not like him, her. So you've heard the word of the Lord. Forgive as Christ forgave you. And you're like, Tarshish is beautiful this time of year. So you hear stories when you come to church about, you know, rich people in the Bible. There's one that you hear a lot. It's Luke 12. It's about this rich fool who decided that he, instead of when he got this bumper crop, he said, well, he should be giving some of it away to what they call the gleaners, the people who are going to come after, and the poor, basically, because they can be blessed by that. But instead, he says, you know what I could do with all this extra grain? I could actually put it in barns, but my barns aren't big enough, so I'm going to build bigger ones, and I'm going to sit on my porch and talk to myself like I'm the only person in the universe. And the Lord comes to him and says, how dare you? Your life is required of you tonight. What are your barns going to do for you now? Yeah, you hear this story, like it, in fact. It's a fascinating story. You go to your small group and you talk about what are the bigger barns and how is it that we do these sorts of things? And then a year later, you get this bumper crop, right? The Lord's blessed your business in a way that he's never done before. It's amazing. What are you going to do with all this extra money? I sure would like to buy a little piece of Tarshish. Well, I know I've heard the word of the Lord, but again, land in Tarshish is great. You're a dating couple. You've been dating for, year and a half. You're committed Christian people. You really want to follow Christ with the way that you're dating. You know, you know the Bible has passages like 1 Thessalonians 4 that says, this is the will of the Lord for you, that you flee sexual immorality. And you're like, yes, I'm committed to that whole thing, but man, she looks good. And the longer you date and the longer you go along, the more she looks gooder. And so you start working in your mind. I know what the Bible says about this, but the Bible is really kind of an outdated book when it comes to sexual mores, right? It didn't know about things like orientation. It doesn't understand the sexual drive like we understand it today. They didn't know all of those things. They didn't have psychologists and other groups that were studying this thing like us. And then you start playing games like I don't want to be, I don't want to get involved in a relationship where we're sexually incompatible. You know what? Look, I know what the word of the Lord says. I know what it says, but I sure would like to have a piece of my girlfriend, Tarshish. Rejecting the word of the Lord is a stupid move for all of us. It will always lead you into greater pain and greater heartache than you could ever imagine. You might not get eaten by a fish, but your life will go straight off the rails. The Bible is replete with examples of people denying the word of the Lord and then it just falling apart. So here I am. Guess what? The Lord called you to be here today. I believe in the providence of God in such a great way that all of the factors that led you here on this Sunday morning were all because the Lord wanted you to sit here and listen as the pastor was sent to you to proclaim the word of the Lord over you. He's preaching against you because he loves you. So now you've heard the word of the Lord, and what do you want to do? You want to go to Tarshish, pretend like this never ever happened? There's a profound foolishness in fleeing from the word of the Lord. But you know, and I know, look, the right answer to this question is, what do you want to do? Well, not what Jonah did. What do you want to do? I want to turn to the Lord and say, yeah, my heart is filled with Tarshish, man. I want to turn to you and say, you are better. You know better. Your way is better. I know that I am prone to wander. Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. But I need you to help me go to Nineveh. Again, you could leave today. Whether you've made a commitment to Christ before or not, you could leave today out of those doors fully assured that the Lord your God will be yours forever and ever and ever, and that greatest joy and eternal goodness will be yours. You could walk out today like that. But listen, if you're going to go out the doors and drive to Tarshish, I just got to tell you, there's only danger there. So what do you want to do? We're only 3 verses into this, right? Like 3 verses. What in the world are we going to do? But listen, next week, Jonah gets eaten by a fish and I'm going to mime the entire thing. All right, let me pray. Father, I thank you for my friends and I pray, Lord, that, Lord, look, you are so kind and gracious to us to, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for reproof and correction and training. The man and woman of God might be mature, fully equipped for every good work. So that's why we're here, Lord, is to actually be reproved and rebuked and trained in righteousness. And sometimes, like when we go into the gym and have to lift weights, our muscles are sore afterwards. And sometimes, Father, in the church, our hearts are sore after it. But the solution is always toward Nineveh. It's always away from Tarshish. You are better, Jesus. You are more than we could ever ask or imagine. The joy you want to give us surpasses any of the joys that we will settle for in this world. You're magnificent. Would we have eyes to see your magnificence and hearts that want to respond to run to you instead of away? Oh, we're so thankful for our Lord Jesus. We're thankful for our Father who welcomes us home like the prodigals we are and puts a ring on our finger and puts a robe over our shoulders and celebrates. May there be a lot of celebrating today. In Jesus' name, amen.
word for us. The goodness of the Lord is never ending. He loves you. I don't know how you came in here today. Maybe you are headed toward Tarshish. And this is a day that the Lord used his word to get to your heart. You're like, I know where I need to go. I've been wandering. I've been everything but. He's calling you back. He's calling you back to the goodness of God so that you could experience it, that you could grow in it, that you could thrive in that relationship. And so we don't want you to leave here today without having an opportunity. We're going to have some leaders down front who will just pray with you. The repentance, it's for real. You can come back or you can come too. And God is standing there with open arms, just ready to receive. So let me pray over us. Lord, you are a good God. Would you have your way in our heart? Would you have your way in our mind? Would you direct us back to you, because you are awesome. So Lord, draw our hearts to a tenderness, to your mercy, to your grace. But help us understand this word is for us today. May we respond accordingly. In Jesus' name, amen. So as we go out on mission today, church, take this truth with you and know that you are loved.